My name is Steen Rasmussen. I'm a professor in physics and a center director at the University of Southern Denmark and an external research professor at the Santa Fe Institute in the US. And then I'm also a consultant scientist at the BINC anthology. A personal fabricator is a machine that's able to make pretty much anything. And you are in control of it. In the same way as you are in control of your personal computer, you can use your personal computer to retrieve information, to create information, and to modify information. But the personal fabricator, you can modify the material world. You can actually fabricate things. You can manufacture things. Artifacts you can use in your daily life or for other purposes. So we know that machines exist that can make everything. There was von Neumann, the inventor of the modern computer. He also proved that machines exist that can make everything, including copies of themselves. And these personal fabricators, the vision for us, or the technological vision, is to build machines that can indeed do that. Make everything is maybe a little much, but certainly machines that increasingly will be able to do anything you want them to do. So we've seen them on Star Trek, and these machines, I think, will be available in it won't take a generation. It'll change, fabricator technology will change society fundamentally, because it enables you to both design the stuff you need and make it, and then use it, and then later on recycle the materials for new things you'd like to use, or you feel that you need. And you'd be able to share recipes. I could use your recipes, and you can use my recipes. You could sell me my recipe. You could sell me recipes, and vice versa. There'll be people that are better at doing designing certain things, and vice versa. So, the whole since this technology enables, empowers you to make stuff, most stuff that you need, then the consumerism we have today will certainly be radically changed. There'll still be manufacturing, I'm sure, of certain things centralized, because it just makes most sense, both economically and also resource-wise. But many things will be your responsibility. You'd be able to do it. We are entering a BINC era because many indicators are showing us that things are changing in a radical manner. If you look at the economy as a big indicator, then we can see that we can make value by making software, by making software applications. And it takes humans, capital, and land to make the first copy of this application. But whether we make two copies or a billion copies is virtually without any cost. And if we can sell each copy for a certain amount of money, then we can make profit without production. That's new in the human history. And actually, also increasingly more material goods can be made very, very, very inexpensively. We actually have there's a general trend that most stuff that we make, the marginal cost of production, they approach zero. And these two things have a huge impact on our economy, and they are mainly driven by digitization and artificial intelligence and automation. Now, another issue, another thing, that if you look at these products that's based on information and communication technology and including artificial intelligence, they are pretty much global when they are born. That means that everybody on the globe can use them. And if you make a product that's a little bit better than everybody else, or you have a better advertising operation, then you have a situation where winner takes all. So it's quite an unstable market in that way. And this is not this is also a very important factor. Now these things together means that we have to expect that about 50% of all known job functions, they'll disappear in the next 15 to 20 years. Alone the economy, I think, indicates that we have great changes underway. Another sort of indicator is, we can maybe call it the globalization or increased connectivity. We can look at climate change. Climate change is a big issue, and it's also driven by technology. We are now at a place where the human population really is changing the climate. And it's a global issue. Another global issue is that we, because of very inexpensive communication technology and also transportation technologies, now have the whole world being mixed up, meaning that the cultures that has developed for thousands of years in one part of the world are suddenly neighbors to another part of another culture that has developed for another thousand years. And that causes all kinds of constipations, because now suddenly we don't have in a region, we don't have, or within a nation state, we don't have consensus about what it means to be human or how the world is. So that is a big transformation too. I would also mention that human activities is actually in the process of making another, I think it's the sixth global extinction of species. And it means that many, many species are actually dying off because of our activities. So if you look at sort of the global scale, then there are dramatic changes. Some of them are good and some of them are bad, but there are certainly dramatic changes. Another indicator is what it means to be human. And we today have the ability to select the kind of baby you'd like to have. A woman has thousands of eggs, and you can, as a woman today, have a number of eggs fertilized, and then you can pick the most promising version of your child. I mean, of course, you can sort bad diseases out, but this selection of your offspring is something you can do today, and this is actually happening. Now, it doesn't take long before we'll be able to also modify our genetics. These new technologies, CRISPR has opened up for, enable us to do that. It's still not at all clear how we can make more pretty or more intelligent kids or more compassionate kids or whatever, but that's certainly in the cards. This will happen. Another very big one is that an increasing part of our life is related to cyberspace. And that means that we interact in ways we haven't done before, over distances we haven't done before, and in communities that we haven't done before. And that causes all kinds of issues, like echo chambers. I mean, it's a wonderful possibilities, but there are huge changes underway. So that's certainly also an indicator that something big is coming. Now, last thing I want to mention is sort of a conclusion or whatever, and that's the breakdown of our narratives. We have narratives about how the world works and our worldviews, and our worldviews and our narratives, they are for the most part created in the industrial era. And now we see they break down because of these other indicators I've mentioned. And as these narratives about reality, they break down, then we get confused, and that opens up for for fake news. And because what are you supposed to believe in? I mean, the old stories about how the world works, they don't work anymore because they're simply not true anymore. So that's, I think, the fundamental reason why, or if you just want to mention one cause, of course, much more complicated, is because the reason why we are in a post-factual era right now is because our narratives are broken down. So we need to generate, we need to create new narratives that are congruent with our reality. Now, unfortunately, these are very complicated things. I mean, how all this, these different factors interact with each other requires a lot of effort, work and effort for scientists from many different disciplines. And because it's so cross-cutting, then it's virtually impossible. It's very, very difficult to get research funding to explore these things, although it is, as far as I can tell, maybe one of the most urgent issues that we as societies and humanity would want to know. How the heck do we navigate this this transition? And one of the big issues is how dramatic, of course we cannot predict what the future will be, but we will be able to say something about, or it will be nice to know how big these changes are. Carl Schwab from the World Economic Forum, he's sort of named this transition for the fourth industrial revolution. And I'm not sure whether we can actually keep this industrial framework in this new transition. I actually believe that this transition is going to be more dramatic or more radical. So we'll have to change our constitution, and then we should, instead of looking at, you know, some of the changes we've had during the industrial era, we should instead look at how historically we should look at what happened when we went from an agricultural built based society to an industrial based society. So these are really exciting and very important issues. Okay, how long time will it take before we have changed paradigm until we've actually left the industrial era? I think we should think about this. We have to think about two timescales. One of them is the technological timescale. How fast are these technological changes occurring? And they are happening very fast. If you just look at history, think about how computing was a generation ago. I mean, when I was a student, our computers, they were the size of a house. And today I have a way, way more powerful computer in my pocket, in my phone. And I believe, just referring to these personal fabrication technologies, I don't think it's going to take a generation before we have machines that pretty much can make everything, including copies of themselves, so that other people can use them to make whatever they need to make. And of course, it doesn't stop there. If you look at the history of humanity, we've kept on making up new stuff. So there will be many other technological changes. Now, the other timescale has to do with our constitution and our legal system, our school system, the way we understand democracy, our banking system, etc., etc. That's going to take much longer to change. So that we're talking about longer than a generation. And again, look at the history. What happened when we went from an agriculturally based society to an industrial based society? It took a better part of, well, it certainly took several generations before we got all the new constitutions in place, etc. So think about these two timescales. Technology is moving fast. Our cultural changes, they are much slower. Today we have laws that ensures our access to clean air and clean water, to public land, to the beaches. And as Leif Rasmussen mentioned or stated, we should make similar laws for living and intelligent process. These are fundamentally natural resources. These are associated with the way the world works. So no law should unduly restrict access to living and intelligent processes or systems that's for the benefit of the people. So we have to find a balance. The challenge is to find a balance between free enterprise and the huge drive there is for innovation when you as individuals, a company, want to make things better. We certainly should not prevent that from happening. But we have to balance that up against the public trust so that we get the best possible outcome. And of course, we'll have different perspectives on the best possible outcome in. But as we get the more and more powerful machines that can actually do this manufacturing at home, these personal fabricators, they will increasingly be more like living systems, and they will be intelligent and they'll be running on code. So we should have the ability to exchange information and materials and designs freely as a default. But of course, there would have to be there would still have to be room or place for private enterprise to be the stewards of some of these things, as we also see today, being stewards about clean water or whatnot. But that's a big issue, and these issues, these balances, are increasingly more important. If you are in a world where you are completely suppressed and your freedoms has been stolen, and there is a tiny ruling class, and you are and you don't have any ability to protect your own welfare or your children's welfare, of course you have to. I think it's a human right to grab power. So this is the story of being suppressed. I mean, the history is filled with people that are being suppressed, and they have to grab the power back. And the power is knowledge. At any given time, it's always knowledge. And now it's these very powerful technologies. So if that happens, then of course we as individuals, we'll have to defend our human rights, basic human rights, and we would, if that's the only way to do it, then we would have to take this intellectual property back to us, because at the end of the day, it's of course human beings that has created it, and we're all part of that. It's a big issue, privacy and security in cyberspace. And when when we usually talk about, have conversations about privacy on the internet, then most people think about, oh, this is, you know, more targeted ads, where we've all experienced how we kind of got surprised. How could they know that I'm looking for this, that, and the other? But that's not what I'm talking about. That, I don't think that's harmful. It can be irritating, and there are ways to avoid it, but no, that's not what I'm talking about. I'll give some concrete examples. Brexit and the election of Trump are examples of how big data can be used in a way to manipulate the election, the outcome of the election. Cambridge Analytica is a corporation that does exactly that, and they used targeted ads, paid ads in Facebook, among other things, to tip by reminding voters that might want to vote for the other party about some bad news or some bad news stories from earlier, so that they stayed at home. So big data used for targeted elections is a big deal, I think. Another issue is Epstein and Robinson. They approved, or they published a paper in PNS a couple of years ago, where they showed that if you, in your search, when you are looking at two parties and you don't quite know which one to look at, it has to be pretty close to each other. If you then push the bad stories, the bad news up in the search for one of the parties, then you can definitely switch. You can flip the election. So I'm not saying Google is doing that, but I'm just saying, unless we make sure that our private data are protected, we can kiss free elections goodbye. Another issue is a fair market. And I'll just give an example. If you as a business you really depend on people contacting you via the internet, then oftentimes you have to pay Google, because Google has monopoly, to bring you up first in the searches. Now, when I talk to CEOs and to cyber experts in this area, I can give an example of photo.com, and the CEO, she says that, look, I've paid Google exactly so much that I can, because Google knows exactly how much I can afford to pay. So I'm really not competing against my competitors. I'm giving all this revenue to this big shark in the tank. There's only one big shark in the tank, and that's Google. So if you do not take care, if you don't have rules so that you cannot just take your private data, you can kiss the fair market goodbye. Now, last thing I want to mention is that if you think about how much we know about each other if we collect all this big data, and then think about a dictatorship. If you can be identified with all this big data, then a surveillance operation today, I mean, if you compare that with surveillance operations they had in Stasi in East Germany, Stasi is just, it's a toddler's operation compared to what we can do today. And 10 years from now, once we've gotten the AI up and running, it's terrifying. So if you don't care about, or if you care about not being ruled by a dictator, suppressed by a dictator, you better make sure that we get good privacy and security laws for cyberspace. Now, it doesn't need to be like that, because there are two fundamental principles that we can apply. If we make sure that all our activities online is done in a way so that we can't be identified, then the companies can still get our data. We can prove mathematically that we are who we are without they knowing who we are, and so that should be fine. The other big issue is that for vital activities, search engines, power and whatnot, I mean all the vital things, we need to have open source. We need to have access to to the algorithm so that we can have a democratic oversight, so that we can ensure that these bad things doesn't happen, and then we can use all these beautiful and wonderful and smart technologies to the fullest without risking losing the farm in doing that. Now, the big issue is, I think, that neither the press nor our governments are really aware of these things, or at least many of them are not. And that's a big issue. If you look at the Danish press, there's very few people that has any clue how these new technologies could be used in a different way. And the same is true for the parliament. I've spent quite a bit of time talking to many people and surveying these issues. And I can just give an example here. We had last year, we had a privacy and cybersecurity hearing in the Danish parliament. And as we'd been there whole day, we were about 80 experts from NGOs and academia and industry. And in conclusion, one of the speakers from one of the major parties stood up and said, thank you for today. And however, sort of at the end of the day, we have to accept that we will have much more surveillance. And there was about 80 hands that went up and said, no, that is a political choice. We have the technology to do things in a different way. So it requires that you and I, we as citizens, we actually wake up and realize how important this is. So privacy and cybersecurity, these are big issues. Yeah, as technology is changing the fundamental, the fundamental building blocks of society, then our narratives have to change. And here is really important to to remember where our narratives they come from. The narratives we have today, for the most part, are created in the industrial era. And one of the narratives that I find oddly, I mean, it's still prevalent, is this idea of left and right and or blue and red. And this is not, that was made a lot of sense in the industrial era, but it doesn't make much sense today, because what does it really say? It talks about a division where you on the one hand have capitalists that make the producers of the goods, the ones that are in power, and then we have the people who are receiving a salary. And today, the most powerful capital equipment you can own is a PC. A PC has for many years been this piece of equipment that you can generate most value with, period. So, and most of us receive a salary. So this is a mock, it's not a very useful way of looking at the world. Here, in my opinion, or the way I see it, is we have four fault lines, really important ones. And it's true, one of them has to do with inequality. Inequality, a growing inequality, in particular within nation states, is a huge, it's a really, really big deal. And that's, a favorite one for the political left, the old political left. But that's important for everybody, because if we have too much inequality, you have instability, and it's bad for the economy. It doesn't matter how you look at it, this is not a good thing. And one good thing in the big picture is that the global inequality is actually decreasing. But we have some local or regional very big challenges in particular. I mean, you can see in the US and in the UK, things have really there's really a big difference between the very few that are getting fewer and fewer, and the most others that are not having very much. Now, the other big division line, or the other big battlefield, is freedom, and that's the favorite of the traditional old right. But freedom today has to do with privacy of data and security. It's cyber privacy and it's cyber security. And you cannot have individual freedom today unless you have protection of your privacy, and also protection of your right to share and your right to use things that you've made. So it very much has to do with legislation that enables us to keep our fundamental human rights. Now, the next one I will mention is environmental issues, and never before has this human activity meant so much for our environment. And we are in the middle of the of yet another mass extinction of species here on the Earth that's caused by us. We are having a major impact on the climate, and how you want to deal with that is another big battleground. There's still, I'm sorry, idiots that doesn't want to believe that we actually have a huge impact on our environment. Fortunately, it's a dying race, but that is a really big issue. So it's depending on how you deal with that issue, that will say something about where you are politically. And this is traditionally something that the Greens like to focus on. Now, the last big issue has to do with globalization, and globalization means how you in this particular context is how technology has, information and communication technology has brought us close together, and the cost of moving both materials and people over large distances is very inexpensive. So and that means that cultures that has been developing over eons, I mean thousands of years, they're suddenly becoming neighbors. So how we deal with that is a great challenge also, and how you come out on some people, they absolutely hate people that are different from themselves, and other people love it. So So we can see all these nationalist movements that are coming up many places in the world today. They are fueled by this big issue. And it's a complex problem how you want to deal with it. On the one hand, you cannot, now for instance, we are here in Denmark, we have a welfare state. We cannot feed everybody from Africa or from the Middle East, so we cannot just let everybody come in on the one hand, but on the other hand, we have to help when people are in dire straits. So the balance on how we deal with that is of course complex, like all the other issues are. But these are the four things that we should think about. And that's also why in this country anyways, it doesn't matter in Denmark whether we have the left wing or right wing government. It matters for a few, sometimes fraction of a percentage point of where the tax is and which group will benefit and which group will not. And for these people, of course, it has a huge impact. But everybody pretty much everybody in the Western world, or at least in Europe here, we believe that we want to have a liberal society with some degree of welfare and where we help each other also if somebody gets sick. So it's I'm looking forward to the day when the press and I guess the rest of us figure out that these are the issues, so we don't just try to paint our political discussions in red and blue, because it's not productive.